What are the biggest mistakes to avoid for a sincere Christian wanting a personal relationship with God?
Well, yeah, this question caused me to think a little bit about things. I feel the single... There are so many mistakes to avoid, as we've been discussing, but I think in my notes of it, I think I just felt that the single biggest mistakes I felt for a Christian were to assume that my blood or belief in my sacrifice saves them from their sins and establishes a relationship with God.
Mm-hmm.
This is a very big mistake to believe this. What establishes a relationship with God is the desire of the individual to have a relationship with God and to receive divine love through the process of prayer. That's what establishes a relationship with God. If you believe anything else establishes a relationship with God other than that, you will never establish a relationship with God. You may establish a lot of relationships with spirits claiming to be God, and you may establish a relationship with spirits claiming to be the Holy Spirit, but they're not God either.
Mm.
And you may establish a whole heap of relationships with spirits claiming to be Jesus, because there's literally hundreds of thousands of them as well. But you will not establish a relationship with God.
Mm.
And I feel the biggest single mistake that a Christian can make is to not establish a relationship with God, not through my blood or any sacrifice that I'm meant to have made, but through desire to know God and love God and have God know them and love them. And I feel that is the biggest single thing I would love to see a Christian change on, getting away from this viewpoint that I save them in some way, that somehow my blood establishes a relationship with God for them, and getting into this concept that their relationship with God is a personal relationship that they personally must desire to establish before it can be established.
Because when you look at some of the scripture writings, it gets all very dry and legalistic with covenants and this and that. And
it does.
It takes away from that pure beauty of just having a give and take father-child relationship. You're talking about covenants and this and that. And
well, with all the covenants, you have to understand them from the heart in order to understand what their meaning is. The truth is that God did make a covenant with mankind through myself, and this covenant was the covenant of the heart. And the covenant of the heart, the new covenant, is where God will write the law, the word of God, on the heart of the individual who is governed by this covenant.
Okay.
So if a person listens to what I teach, what I actually teach, not what they think I taught in the Bible or what they think I should have taught, but rather what I actually teach, they will find that I then become the mediator of this covenant for them.
Wow.
In the sense that because I've taught divine truth to them, I can now help them establish through this covenant that God has made, that basically God is saying to all humans, every single human, doesn't matter who they are, God is saying to all humans, no matter how bad or how good they are, I make a covenant with you. I'm going to provide you a person. In this case, it was Jesus.
Mm.
I'm going to provide you a person who's going to show you how to connect to me to the point where I will be able to write my word on your heart, not just as I've written my word on his heart. In other words, you can have God's law written on your heart the same way that Jesus has God's law written on his heart. If you engage the covenant in that regard, then you will come to God.
Wow.
So that helps you understand what the covenant's all about, right?
It does,
the
new covenant. Very much so.
But if you look at the covenant in terms of a discussion of legalism.
Talk about a covenant of blood and all.
And all these things. Now, of course, you're getting way offline.
Yes.
And it becomes very complicated. Also, God made no covenant of blood. If you think about it,
no.
All blood on this planet belongs to God already.
Yeah. Well, that's it.
So how can any of us make a sacrifice that doesn't already belong to God?
Yeah.
We can't.
And didn't that come from the old Middle Eastern belief in Baal?
Well,
wasn't he a blood god, you know?
Yes, the way where it came from was that prior to pre-Christian times, there were many, many religions who believed in this wrathful God.
Mm.
And what they believed was they either had to please the gods or sacrifice for the gods. In fact, they believed that pleasing the gods was sacrificing for the gods. They also believed that the way to get more from God, if you like, or have God's approval, was to give God the first fruits of whatever you did.
Yep.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Now, for many of these religions, it meant the firstborn of their children.
Mm.
So they would actually, the child would be born and they'd have a certain day of the year where they'd actually sacrifice the child. They'd cut the child up and burn it to their God, right? And they believed that they would that would actually cause them to then have God's blessing for the rest of the year. Does that make sense? Now, Abraham came from these particular belief systems. And Abraham had more love in his soul.
Mm.
And he felt, obviously, that these belief systems were, you know, obviously not very loving, right?
Oh, yes.
It's quite obvious but to us now. But, of course, when you're driven by fear, it's not very obvious. But Abraham had less fear in his soul about, you know, towing the line, the status quo, as we might say nowadays. So he felt that there must be another way to connect to God. Now, in doing this, he received inspiration from spirits that God didn't want sacrifice. And in fact, there are parts of the Bible where it says very plainly, God saying, I do not want sacrifice.
Yeah.
I want obedience and not sacrifice, right?
Yeah.
So this is, you know, these are the things that we need to understand, that God doesn't want sacrifice. God would like to have obedience instead.
Mm.
And that means obedience to God's laws. Whenever we obey God's laws, we'll always be happier.
Mm.
But we have to voluntarily do so because we have free will. But in Abraham's case, he decided, these spirits, through this process that he had with his son Isaac, got him to recognize that he didn't need to sacrifice his firstborn anymore. And instead what they did is they substituted animals instead.
Yes, yes.
So there was still this belief that blood somehow saved or appeased the God.
Mm.
Abraham believed, was one of the first persons in his neighborhood who believed in one God, not in many, because it was very popular to believe in many gods.
Mm.
So he believed in one true God. But he still had this concept of God that was quite damaging in the sense that he still felt that God required the sacrifice of a living creature in order to be appeased in some manner or in order to be a sacrifice for his sins, as the saying goes.
Yes.
Now, this this became the foundation of the Judaism and the Jewish religion. Now that was around for 1,500 years or so before I arrived on the planet. And I, of course, felt that that was barbaric because I had been to the temple and saw the blood running down the side streets near the temple of all of these animals that were being sacrificed for the sins of people who were committing them next day generally anyway. And they had no effect on God whatsoever aside from God smelling the stench of the animals being destroyed and killed. And that's what caused me to become a vegetarian in the first century, which very few people actually know. But if you look at it, that concept of sacrifice through Paul got drawn into Christian religion faith, religious faith. Now, when I say through Paul, it's through Paul's writings, so-called Paul's writing, but Paul didn't actually believe it either.
Okay.
So these were modifications to Paul's writings that occurred that Paul even himself didn't believe.
Right.
And but that got added to try to put together patterns from the Old Testament to the New.
Yes, so, they were always trying to reflect back the Old and the New Testament, reflecting back on each other.
Exactly.
Yes.
It was an attempt to draw together what they felt was the Bible canon and explain it to people. And so they then called me the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world.
Mm.
Now, I personally cannot take away a single individual's sin. Mm. I can teach them something that will take away their sin, but only if they follow my words, only if they follow my teachings.
Mm.
That can take away sin. But I personally am not capable, through my death, of taking away a single person's sin, even my own, ironically. These are all teachings that were put together, again, coming from old, mixing it up, drawing it into the new, because people find change very difficult. You know that. Even now when I'm speaking to groups of people in an audience, you'll hear them saying, so are you meaning that that's what I heard about this? And I'm saying, no, it's not that at all. And they go, oh, that's what I thought you were saying. Mm. And you know what I mean? They're always trying to bring in the old to the new.
Yeah.
Rather than just go, hang on a second, let's just forget the old for a moment.
And just start off.
And just start fairly fresh. Mm. And let's only bring in the old when it sort of aligns with the new, you know, when it makes sense, when it's logical. But most people don't do that, of course. And unfortunately, by bringing in the old, they distort the new. Right, yeah. And this is what happened very rapidly to my teachings. So in the first century, even while I was alive, I had people repeating to me my teachings in the way they understood them, which was not the way I was teaching them while I was alive. Mm. And so it was undoubtedly going to happen when I died.
Wow.
Even while I'm alive now, I can reassure people over and over again, no, in the first century, that's not what I taught. And they'll still believe that that's what I taught.
Yeah.
You know, modified teachings get told back to me. Like, I even get told, this is Jesus getting told what Jesus said in the first century. Well, surely Jesus knows what Jesus said in the first century. Like, and this is because people don't believe I'm Jesus, of course, just like in the first century, they didn't believe I was the Messiah. Mm. And so they were always trying to bring in the old to try to make sense of it all.
Yeah.
And this is also not a very productive thing in terms of a person's future.
Yeah, for sure.
Mm. Mm. So my suggestion to Christians is to consider what's being said in these questions, and at least consider the bits that they feel they can consider without disagreeing with the disharmony of what they already have inside of themselves, if they want to.
Yeah.
But understand that when they pass into the spirit world, they have these beautiful options of talking to the people who were with me in the first century.
Yes.
They have the option of hearing from them.
Do they just call for them or ask for them?
All they need to do is call for them and they'll come. Mm. And instead of going, oh, no, you're telling me something different to what the Bible says, so I can't listen to you, put that down for a moment. Nothing could be harmed by putting it down for a moment. And listen to the people who were with me in the first century and ask them, what did Jesus actually say here? Right? What did Jesus say about this? Is Jesus God? Is the Holy Spirit God? Does Jesus' sacrifice clear me from my sin? Why am I where I am now? Mm. Ask them the questions and let these bright spirits, who obviously have a lot of light, therefore a lot of love, share with you how they have learned to live in love.